since 20 years around the world, and I never made it to India. But I knew from day one when I started this. Because when you create something new which is related to medical aspects, even if it's complementary and alternative, then you not only face the challenge by convincing people to take a look at it or to try it. The other challenge you're facing is you are immediately related to government regulations, etc. And you know, healthcare is a very high regulated field. And when you come with something new, which most of the people in the classical medical field do not understand, then it's like, you know, hitting the wall all the time, and you can't go further a step. And this was actually the biggest challenge which I faced now since almost 20 years, 19 years and a couple of months I'm in this business already. And but there is a paradigm shift going on, because healthcare is not foreign anymore, and even the governments, doesn't matter which country, they face this challenge that they cannot provide first-class healthcare for all the people anymore. And on the other hand, we have a lot of changes in our wonderful planet, which probably is not yet fully understood what's going on with our environment, etc., and the impacts we create on our organisms. We have a lot of new diseases coming out, mostly chronic diseases, which we have no clue where they come from, and finally, we have no clue how to treat them. In the classical medical field, we have to give a name to every disease, just because without a name, we cannot write an invoice. You know? And therefore, there's a lot of things going on. And my goal for today is to not only introduce this technology to you. I'm always a visionary. I was and I will always be a visionary. So I will also hopefully create an impact to change some perception when we look at healthcare in general, especially when we discover the new evolving faculties within the medical field, which is not only energy medicine. There's another one going on, and I would like to introduce this to you, a short presentation before we start, because this short presentation will give you a little bit of an idea about how I think about all this and what's my basic to invent technologies which hopefully not change the world but create an impact and change people's perception. Me personally, I was into sports until the age of 26. I was a hockey player, and I got diagnosed with a non-Hodgkin's lymphoma when I was 26. So I suffered from cancer, and at that time I had absolutely no knowledge about medicine. And I realized the only way for me to become proactive in this process of staying healthy and not fall back into a new cancer outbreak is to educate myself, because education is the key. It's not the technology. It's, you know, this is great technology, but as long as you do not know what happens when you lie on it and you turn it on, it makes no sense to everybody. And therefore, you know, the educational aspect is the most important aspect if we talk about new horizons in medicine. And this is what I did at that time. You know, I just realized, okay, you have no clue about what's going on, so you have to educate yourself. So I started my journey, and the second aspect, which was very interesting when I came out of the hospital, a lot of people approach you, and they give you ideas, they give you tips. You know, they want to help you. You should not eat this anymore. You should drink this. You should see this doctor. You should see this. No, don't use this homeopathics. Use this. Use that. If I would follow all these hints, I would probably be dead already, because of all the interacting effects between everything what I should eat and what I should drink. More and more I realized it might be good what people tell me, but as long as you do not understand it, it makes no sense for you to take it. And then I started my journey into personal research, education. I visited a lot of conferences, especially at that time, you know, the energy medical field started emerging. So, but not in Germany. It started in the eastern part of the world, mostly in the Baltic states, Hungary, then Russia. So I visited all these conferences, and then, you know, it was on a press conference in Austria. It was about 6 or 7 months after I left the hospital, and somebody came to me and he said, I have something for you, because he knew about my story and he knew about my attitude of researching and everything and educating myself. And then he introduced PEMF technology to me. And it was at that time when the first units, PEMF, pulsed electromagnetic field units for home use, appeared on the market. And believe it or not, it happened in Austria, this little tiny country with 8 million people living. So that's probably just a tiny little part of Delhi, according to the people living there. And this person introduced this technology to me, and he gave me a 45-minute one-on-one lecture. And I was so impressed about the knowledge, about the science behind it, that it attracted my attention. And then I bought one of these machines. Just because, not because I was sure that it will help me. I was so eager to try this, because from what he told me, that it must be it. I bought a machine. At that time, it was very expensive. It was about 500,000 rupees. I learned already the exchange rate. Took me a while. And I bought it, and I started using it. My problem was, beside all the side effects of the chemotherapy and everything, I had another problem. I was suffering from insomnia. I couldn't sleep. So this is a very a smart combination. You are already below the carpet with your energy level, and then you are not able to regenerate, you cannot sleep. So that really took me almost out of life. And he was mentioning that this machine, the basic unit, the prototype, which was developed in Germany in the Technical University in Munich, it was a machine which was called the sleeping machine. So the first prototype built based on BMF units and used on human beings was a unit which helps to get rid of insomnia. So that was the first indication for PEMF devices. And this was actually the trigger for me to buy this. So I used it, and I used it faithfully. He told me, just lay down 3 times a day for 8 minutes on this mat, turn it on there was only, it was only a square box with intensity level 1 to 10 on and off. That's it. It was a whole body map. And I had no clue what's inside. And so I turned this machine on 3 times a day for 8 minutes. And you know, the cool thing was, I didn't have to do anything, just to lay down. It doesn't, you know, pinch you. It doesn't even make noise. So how can something help in our understanding, which doesn't do anything? Makes no sense, right? Even till today, it makes no sense for people that you know, there are some kind of information emitting from this mattress, and you don't even feel it, and it shall create an impact. So this is something weird. And I did it, and I did it faithfully for 4 weeks. And you know what happened after 4 weeks? Nothing. Nothing happened. You know? After 4 weeks, I couldn't feel maybe a very slight improvement, but you know, because I was very ill at that time, I didn't realize that. And then, of course, you can imagine what I did. I called this person. You know, I was swearing like crazy. I was born and raised in Bavaria. You know, we invented swearing with our dialect, so it was pretty insane. So, you know, I told him something like, I don't like this machine, I want to send it back to you, and I want to get my money back. And then he, you know, he was convincing me on the phone, and he said one interesting sentence. He said, Wolfgang, you have to understand, this is not a pill, this is not a medication, this is not a shot, an injection, this is a regulation system. And to regulate, it takes some time, and you cannot expect, you know, He said, the system does already good things to you, but you don't feel the output already. There's a shift going on, and regulation takes time. So I please you to invest more time, give it another 4 to 6 weeks, because I expect a change within this time frame. Thank God I went on with it, and after 2 additional weeks, I had my first breakthrough, because I had my first night sleeping 10 hours like a baby. And this was so important for me, because when I woke up in the morning, I realized for the first time that my body was able to regenerate, which I couldn't feel for months. And then I realized, wow, there might be some processes going on in your body, and this mat, which I used for that, is only the initial trigger, you know, to literally, you know, put the body in another stage so that it can start helping you. And from that day, I got better day by day, and it took me only 3 to 4 months, and I was close to the same person that I was before the cancer. Not physically, because I still had a lot of problems physically, but mentally and energetically, I was almost the same person. And I would never say, even till today, I never said that once in over 2,500 lectures I did all over the world, that this thing healed my cancer. But it helped me, it helped my body to reach a certain stage where the body was able to help itself. And from that day, my life changed, because my one and only perspective in my life was not to think about sport anymore. It was to think about PMF and how to get this to the people. I'm a marketing guy. I'm not a physician. I don't have a medical degree. But I'm a marketing person, and I'm a visionary. That's what I can do. I can create products in my mind which people like. And that's the most important thing when you come out also in medicine, especially for technologies for home use. These systems, they not only have to work, they also have to look good, feel good, because otherwise people will not ask for these devices, and we don't get the technology. And based on the machine I bought 20 years ago, I started to developing my own system based on the research I did over years. And then that was the birthday of the MRS 2000, which is the predecessor to this system which we have nowadays. The IRS, today we have the fifth generation of these devices. We have about 1 million users every day in the whole world. So we have already also a lot of metadata which we can use to improve this technology stage by stage. And we also figured out, because 20 years ago when we started, we didn't know for which kind of indication this system can help. You only need one thing, it's a sleeping machine. It puts you to sleep better. And all the conditions we accompany nowadays with this healing modality are based on the experiences we collected over almost 2 decades. And there are more and more and more, I mentioned that, new diseases coming out because of some slight changes in our environment. And we figure out that this system, whenever there is something, it creates a positive impact when it comes to healing. So the idea of PNF is not that it's created for a special condition with a specific treatment. You know, it is much more fundamental than this, because it seems to create a shift in your entire organism. No, this system doesn't care what you have, whether it's fibromyalgia, whether it's cancer, it doesn't matter. You name it, it doesn't matter. But what it does, it creates a fundamental shift in your body, which activates the ability of the body to help and to heal itself. And that's pretty fundamental, and that's pretty unique in the medical world, whether it's the classical medical field or the complementary and alternative field. that we have such a modality with such a fundamental impact on each of your 75 trillion cells. And this technology is able to do that. And we will investigate this during the day, why we have this ability and what's the research and the science behind, and of course also how do you apply it, how does it work. That's what actually happens the whole day. But before, I would like to introduce a new faculty to you, which in my opinion is very interesting, and which everybody who is motivated to look into energy medicine has to concern also, and this is talking about evolution. Because evolution is definitely an interesting topic. By the way, that's my 2-year-old daughter. She likes evolution. She's built on it. Yeah? So, what is evolutionary medicine? Evolutionary medicine, sometimes also known as Darwinian medicine, according to Charles Darwin, is an emerging interdisciplinary field that is gaining increasing recognition across many disciplines and already has a strong tradition within anthropology. So it's the, you know, to look at the environmental influences when it comes to health and disease. And this gets more and more interesting because of the many changes in our environment. I can tell you from the perspective of an energy medicine related person, all clinical medical studies which are done nowadays are not replicable anymore. And do you know why? Because all these studies, the study design, does not include the environment around it. So, very simply explained, if you have an incubator and you do a clinical study and you have a mobile phone lying beside the incubator, the study is not applicable anymore. Bingo. If you have an incubator which is an environment where you have a lot of electronic devices beside, where you probably have a train passing by 25 meters running by electricity, your study is not applicable anymore. Because from the understanding of, nobody wants to bring it to the table because that will have a huge impact on the world economy. But I can briefly tell you, if you use your mobile phone 30 minutes a day for about 15-20 years, your risk of getting brain cancer is 840 times higher. That's what it is. You know, the studies are there. I can give you access to these studies, no problem. But nobody wants to bring it on the table. And a little metaphor for you, how I always explain the difference between classical medicine and complementary or holistic medicine is, if you have a goldfish at home in a fishbowl, the goldfish becomes ill. You go to a doctor, said my fish is ill, does not feel well. The classical medical doctor, he does, he takes the fish out of the fishbowl, and then starts, you know, looking what's wrong, maybe an MRI, maybe an ultrasound, and then, you know, they can find something, they're going to fix it, they put the fish back, fish is good. You take the fish home, after 2 weeks, the fish becomes ill again. You again go to the doctor. Again, the examinations, you know, we have protocols in the classical medicine, this is what we do. You know, okay, if we find something, it's okay, if not, well, probably the food was not good, it's getting better. This is the way. If you take the fish with a fishbowl to a holistic medical person who has already an idea about evolution, environment, you know what this person does? First of all, before he even touches the fish, changes the water. That's philosophy, you know, of holistic medicine. Sometimes we have to change the environment to see whether we create, whether we make a difference. We We do that when we change, when we divorce. Divorce is changing the environment, right? You know, you try to fix everything. You try to fix the symptoms in a relationship over a certain amount of time, and if it's not working out, you change the environment. And then what happens is that people feel totally different. They suddenly see the new pathway where they can go. You know, there is a new horizon opening up. This is actually what we do with holistic medicine. You know, changing the environment. And if it comes to electromagnetic fields, you will hear that quite often. For example, when people sleep not very well, don't sleep very well. You know, you also, as an energy medicine related person, you have to look in which environment this person is sleeping. And before doing anything on the organism itself, maybe you have to make some slight changes in the environment. And in a lot of cases, people start sleeping better just by changing the environment, turning off the alarm clock, taking away the mobile phone from the nightstand. You know, I can tell you, if you have a mobile phone on your nightstand, this has a tremendous impact on your quality of sleep. So instead of going to five doctors and taking pills, turn it off. Nobody calls you at 2 o'clock in the night. You know? Turn it off and you have a better sleep. And we know sleep is healing. You know, we heal when we sleep. In other words, we are under stress. And that's why sleep is so important to me. Sleep is the best medicine. And evolutionary medicine. So actually, it takes an ultimate view on diseases and our health, arguing that our vulnerability and our well-being should be viewed from an evolutionary perspective. We are designed to arrange ourselves with our environment. We learned that over generations and generations and generations. The problem with us human beings is we evolve very slow. Every 70, 75 years. Sometimes a little bit faster, sometimes a little bit slower, depending on how active we are in our sexual life. Right? But comparing to bacteria, we are slow. There are bacteria, they evolve, they replicate themselves 27,000 times a day. You can imagine that they can adapt much faster to the changes of the environment than we can do. Because we're just very slow creatures. So the evolutionary perspective plays a major role on that. So taking a look at this, it gives us a much better understanding of health and disease. We can learn how we rebalance the organism according to its biological requirements. There are some certain rules, we cannot just go over it. Even if we do it more and more in our stressful days, in our stressful world, we have a lot of pressure. You know, we have to be the best in everything. We have to maintain our work to make a living and so on. So there's a lot of pressure from our environment, which is put on us, and that creates a lot of problems when it comes to health and disease. And there are certain rules, we cannot just go over it. We can always take a pill to prolong certain, but it comes to the point where we cannot go on like this anymore. And then we get these breakdowns. Some call it burnout, some call it stroke, some call it heart attack. You know, it depends on your physiology where you get it first. Where is your weak point? That's what it's about. Detlef Ganten, for example, he's an MD from Germany. He wrote a book about evolutionary medicine, and he was the former head of the Berlin Charité, which is a world-renowned hospital. And these guys, you know, very established medical doctors, world-renowned, they even start looking into these perspectives, environmental energy medicine. So there is something going on. It's not only us, you know, creating technologies and trying to to get this movement going from the bottom. There are also renowned medical doctors from all over the world who are not satisfied with the recent evidence-based medicine we have. And they want to take a step further and look a little bit deeper into new perspective. And there's also another guy, Stephen Stern, from the Yale University you have in Connecticut. He says, almost every aspect of human biology which plays a role in modern medicine is formed by our own evolutionary past. So we are containing of some certain rules we cannot just pass. We have to follow them in order to maintain our health. And if we don't respect them anymore, we become ill. Very simple. So evolution means nothing else than adaptation and mutation. So when we face certain changes in our environment, our organism over time needs to mutate in certain ways to adapt to these new situations. And the information is planted in the genome. The environment creates a huge impact. Our social life creates a huge impact. Nowadays, I travel a lot. I'm sitting in airports many days in a year, and I realized one thing: you cannot talk to people anymore. Everybody is sitting like that. So there's no, 20 years ago, people were still talking to each other. And nowadays, they don't do that anymore. If they would know what I know, they would probably not do this anymore. It took me a lot of years of research to understand that I should not do this every day because it's not good for my health. And then I realized it's also not good for my social life because people are even losing their ability to contact other people. Personally, it's easy, WhatsApp, no problem. You can write everything to everybody because you don't have to face this person. You don't have to see this person. You don't have to smell this person, right? But if it comes to facing a person one-on-one, sorry, I don't speak English. It's not a question of language, it's not a question of just talking. It's also, looking, expression, everything together. And sometimes you don't even need to speak to understand somebody just by making some non-verbal interaction. By the way, we call that resonance. Do you know what's the highest stage of resonance in our lives? What is it called? The highest stage of resonance. Love. Four letters. If you walk along a street and you see a nice lady across the street, and there is a huge portion of resonance, you fall in love. When you fall in love, I think it happened to every one of us already, our body is immediately changing. You get more energy. Right away, bam! It doesn't matter what happened with you before, if you're tired or not. The moment you fall in love, huck! It doesn't matter. So do you see what I want to tell you? What tremendous impact we can create just by information we receive, even without talking. So there might be some kind of interaction even without talking, because otherwise you cannot explain to fall in love. Or the opposite. Did it ever happen to you? You enter a room with 20 people in this room and you do not feel comfortable. You didn't even talk to somebody. And you say, I want to get out of here. This is the opposite of resonance. You do not resonate with all this information in this room. Newton's physics cannot explain that phenomenon. because you cannot measure that force, you know, but you can find a lot of answers in quantum physics. Because we have these little energy parts, some call it quarks, and some call it electrons, neutrons, whatever, you know, there is a force which is leading us in certain directions which we cannot capture. And this is actually probably the field which will be explored more and more, and which even physicians look for an extension of Newton's physics to explain these phenomena by using new technologies. You know, we know that from the medical field, for example, Professor Popp, biophotons. You heard, probably heard about that. Biophotons, we are emerging biophotons, our whole body. You know, some call it aura. In fact, there is something physically going on, which is already measurable. Of course, it's not acknowledged in the classical medical field, but you know, it's measurable, it's there. Here we have there is a little poster here, it says biofield. It seems that we have this biofield. You know, I think you are very familiar with the chakras. You know, where people always think chakra, oh. I don't want to get into that. Right? Especially in the Western world. Because they do not understand that there is actually some energy which is, of course, not capable for that because they do not understand the background. However, these chakras can be even measured nowadays. And there is more and more coming out. We also emit an electromagnetic field because our entire cellular structure does not only work chemically, it works even more electrically than chemically. And even from physics and chemistry, we know there is no chemistry without energy. So it makes total sense, you know, if it comes to health and disease, to not only look on the chemical processes in the body, it makes even more sense to look on the energetic processes. Because without energy, there would be no chemistry. You cannot induce a chemical reaction without energy. And this is the idea of getting this together. So, education plays a huge role, how we evolve, in which direction. And of course, from learning how we finally progress. Sex is also important. According to evolution, sex is not important because it makes people feel good. It has another aspect because sex is necessary to reproduce ourselves. So if we don't practice sexual life, we cannot reproduce ourselves, which is one of the main approaches from every animal and every human being to reproduce ourselves. With reproduction, we evolve over generations and generations. The less we reproduce, the less fast and the less the more complicated will it be to accommodate all these changes of our environment. So, the fast environmental changes and its consequences create an ever-increasing demand on the so-called breeding effort. The breeding effort is important. Thrive to survive. So we need to create more efforts, more and more, to still be able and to maintain the reproduction of ourselves. Because of all these changes in the environment, it becomes more stressful, more challenging for all of us, and therefore, you know, the result is there is more and more selection pressure on anatomy and psychology, or in other words, we lag far behind time. You know, the environment is changing so quickly. Remember, computers, cell phones, we talk about an invention which is not even 25 years old. This is nothing, you know? This is a little spot when we look at the whole history of planet Earth and our personal evolution. But these changes, they are so quick And we try to adapt, but we are far behind the time because we are too slow to reproduce. And this explains why we face so many environmental diseases nowadays, or we call it civilization illnesses, which we don't even know, which we don't even have a clue where they come from. Some call them, they give them names, fibromyalgia. Fibromyalgia is a Latin term. It means nothing else than pain in the muscles and fibers, if you translate it. That's what it is. So it sounds great, fibromyalgia. But in fact, it just explains the symptoms. But nobody has a clue where it comes from. People in the energy medical field, they have a clue where it comes from, because it's related to the changes of our environment. And then, you know, we change the environment, we change the water of the fishbowl, and suddenly people become better. It's not a miracle, it's just logical, and it totally makes sense. And this is what we have to understand more and more. There's another thing which we call as exercise, movement. Human beings are designed to exercise, to move. You know, our ancient friends, you know, why do you think do we have these strong muscles here? Because we needed them to satisfy the breathing effort. There were no cars, no elevators, no escalators, no airplanes, no bicycles. You know, to get food, we had to invest a lot of efforts. That's why we have strong muscles here. Because our ancient friends, they walked about 25 kilometers a day. Not because they like to hike. It's because they were looking for food to survive. And, you know, because, again, we evolved so slow, the problem is we still have these muscles, but they are more hindering for us than they are good for us. Because sitting in a car, you know, we don't need these muscles. It even gives us pain when we sit for a longer time. And maybe because of our changes in the habits, maybe in 5 million years, we don't have legs anymore. Because we don't use them anymore. And you know, over the evolutionary process, they will just become forgotten. But now we still have them, and because we don't use them anymore the way we should, that even creates problems. We sit more than we stand. That's why we have so many back problems. You know, we are not designed for that. Very simple. We are not designed to sit 8 hours a day. Faulty design. So when we do it, we break the rule, we become ill. Very simple. We don't want to go back to Stone Age. Nobody wants that. I probably would have no problem with it. Because I think it's cool, you know, if you again have to talk to people, you know, you're not exposed to all this artificial information around us. But most of the people say, no, I need my iPad. You know, I need my V6 300 horsepower car, you know, because it's convenient, you know, and that's why I think nobody wants to step back. So these are two examples. I told you already. This is a Helicobacter pylori sitting in the pancreas. This is a guy reproducing about 32,000 times a month. Evolution. That's why the bacteria, even if their brain is not there, according to evolution, they are much more sophisticated than we are. And that's why we have this problem. You know, we cannot conquer certain inflammations caused by viruses or bacteria with modern medicine anymore, because these little fellows are much smarter than the medicine. And they adapt to changes much quicker. So, you know, if it comes to evolution, we are really the worst of the worst, comparing to these people. This is also an interesting example, the saber-toothed tiger. Not on this planet anymore since about 15,000 years. And he actually lost the battle against evolution because of his teeth. You think this teeth, you know, very strong. However, because this teeth, they become weaker and weaker, smoother and smoother over the evolutionary processes, he finally was not able to collect food with his teeth anymore, so he died according to the evolution. He didn't make it. You know, his breeding efforts were not good enough to survive this species. I think the solution nowadays is looking for the niche. We have to still live a modern lifestyle, that's all what we want. We want to enjoy the technology which is given to us. We want to enjoy the environment, the inventions which are brought to us. But we have to look a little bit deeper to still harmonize with the conditions of our biology. Again, there are certain rules you cannot go over. So my idea is to sympathize with our genome. So we have to realize we have these genomes and we have to respect them and we cannot go over it. And designing a life which imitates the necessary conditions for our heritage organism. So let's look into nature, what's good, try to copy it and try to put it into technology and give it back to us. That might be a good idea, which we are able to compensate this lack of evolution by using natural phenomena which are good for our health, putting them into that technology and providing them to the people. And this is the idea of in the philosophy we are working in our company and in regards to utilizing our products, new products. Evolution and disease. If we look at disease, we have two major things we have to look at it, causes and symptoms. Cause describes the initial reason for development of disease. And the symptom describes the subjective or objective appearance of unusual bodily signals. So the symptom is the alarm clock, right? Which tells us something might be wrong, and now I have to look for the cause. Unfortunately, modern medicine doesn't look so much at the causes anymore. It looks primarily to maintain the symptoms, which is economically a perfect pathway. You know, everything has to be put in a pill, has to be swallowed, and the effect should not last too long because we have to buy another pill to keep this economy running. You know? Don't get me wrong, you know, I know there are a lot of doctors sitting there. I'm not against classical medicine, not at all. But when it comes to these civilization illnesses, to this only symptom-oriented diseases, where even nobody has a clue where it comes from, I think it's not the right direction if we just design medication to lower the symptoms, because this will never, ever catch the cause. And as long as you don't catch the cause and reverse the process on a causal way, the body will not be able to heal. And there's even a word for that in the medical field. A lot of people are maintaining their lifestyle in a so-called sub-health status. That's the status between health and disease, where people suffer from a lot of symptoms. In many cases, these symptoms are not even objectively diagnosable. You know, these are most the people they end up at, in the psychiatry because the doctor cannot find any reason for the symptom. And then they say, well, you probably have to change something in your brain because I cannot find anything. Believe me, when there is a symptom, when the body turns on the alarm clock, there is always a reason for it, a physical reason, always. Otherwise, the body would not turn on the alarm. So the symptom is basically nothing else than a little help from our body to tell, hey, do something because something is not wrong. Something is not right, sorry. Fever, for example. Fever is not a disease. Fever is a symptom. You know? And it's not always good to artificially lower the fever. Because fever can help healing. What happens when you suffer from fever? Your body temperature rises. What do you think? Why? Because there might be a virus which can be eliminated with heat. By artificially lowering the fever, you do exactly the opposite of what you should do, because you give the virus the chance to further survive in your body. You know, of course, if the fever reaches a critical number, then we probably have to intervene. But in many cases, it's not necessary. Let the fever do the job because it's a symptom. It's not an illness. Do you know about toxoplasmosis? This is a cool example for evolution and how smart bacteria are. Toxoplasmosis is a disease which you can mostly find in cats. Cats. The problem is the bacteria which is responsible, the parasite which is responsible for that disease, this guy is called Toxoplasma gondii, not Gandhi, gondii. This little parasite is not able to enter the cat directly, because the cat has some defensive properties in the immune system which doesn't let the Toxoplasma gondii directly into the cat's brain. But this fellow is pretty smart, because what Toxoplasma gondii does, he uses the biggest enemy of the cat to finally reach the host, the mouse. So what he does, he attacks the brain of the mouse and takes away, it switches certain buttons so that the mouse has no fear anymore of cats. Which leads to the fact that the cat catches the mouse and our friend Toxoplasma gondii is exactly where he wants to be the cat. That's how smart these little parasites are. No, we are far away from being so smart. So just a little example. So instead of creating more and more medication for symptoms, the real challenge in future of healthcare is to fully understand the functions of symptoms. What is the function of it? Does the symptom has a function? If yes, let it go. Don't intervene. So we have to understand this, you know, and the decision whether and how they need to be attended. Some symptoms need to be attended immediately, some don't have to be. The problem is the authorities, till today, they do not want this. And that's why we still face the problems we have. There was a very interesting 2009, that's a German publication, it's called Der Spiegel. It's a very high acknowledged German magazine. There was a very, very funny and very true story about, it says Fehlkonstruktion Mensch, that's German, and it means human being of faulty design. That report also explains what I told you about our evolutionary process, that we lack far behind time, and why human beings are not made for the modern world. So the problem is, right recently, right now, we are not made for what happens around us. And it probably takes generations of generations to slowly adapt to this new environment. environment we have to face nowadays. That's the challenge we are looking at. That's why evolutionary medicine, in my perspective, is so important that we take a look at this, whether we are in the classical medical field or in the holistic field. You know, it is important to get this into our mind, that whenever we face somebody with a disease, that we always think about the environment as well and the evolutionary process. Finally, some little examples about what's still left in our body and what we actually don't use anymore. It's just there because it doesn't bother us so much. And that's why we carry stuff around, which we actually do not use anymore at all, but because it's not important enough to get away from it, we still have it, the wisdom teeth. The wisdom teeth are absolutely useless. We do not use them anymore. The reason why we do not use them anymore is very simple, because we have convenience food. So we don't need a lot of effort to chew the food which we face nowadays, comparing to the food in the ancient times. And that's why, you know, our jaws become smaller, and then we have the problem that the wisdom teeth, they have no space anymore, but they are still there. So the only thing what the wisdom teeth do nowadays to us is they create a lot of costs in the medical healthcare field whenever they have to be taken off. But in fact, we do not need them at all. Not right now anymore, because everything is too convenient. So our jaws, comparing to 5, 6, 7 generations before, are much smaller than they were before. But we still have it, and maybe in 2 or 3 generations, they will not be there anymore. Because the genomes will be reprogrammed, and you know, one day there is a generation who tells you, you know, the little gene for the wisdom teeth, sort it out, we don't need it anymore. You know, we figured out that the last 6 generations, they don't feel comfortable with it, they don't use it anymore, so let it out. That's what's going to happen. A much more important leftover is the so-called position of the trachea and the esophagus. The tube with the air, the tube with the food. Anatomically, a totally faulty design. Totally. A lot of people died already from this faulty design, because the problem is we cannot breathe and eat at the same time or swallow at the same time. If we try to do that, there's a symptom coming up. That's the hiccup. The hiccup is a symptom, it's based on the faulty design of the close position of the trachea and the esophagus. I think there is no creature in the world which has such a faulty design as we have. But because it still didn't cost our species, it's still there. Maybe in 5 or 6 generations, the mouth is there, the nose is here. Who knows? For us, it sounds, and probably it looks very funny. In 6 generations, when they have it and they look back on our pictures and look how funny they looked at that time. You know, it's always based on the perspective. The next leftover is the appendix. The appendix, it only creates problems and costs. You know, because it has no real function anymore, but you know, If you suffer from an appendix inflammation, you can die from it. So the only thing why we carry this around is because we want to produce costs to the healthcare system. A couple generations before, the appendix was a very important organ because it was still a source and a storage, a retreat area for bacteria. So it was a retreat area for a sleeping task force sitting there, and whenever there was an attack on our immune system, the special GI task force from the appendix went out to challenge the situation. But because of our lifestyle we have, because of our healthcare system, because of everything we have, you know, it seems that at this stage of evolution, we don't need it anymore. The horse, the cow, for example, they still need it. They use it. For us, it's useless, and it creates a lot of costs and problems. Health challenging problems even can lead to death when we do not treat an appendix inflammation. This is a very cool example. Natural childbirth versus C-section. Why? In medical terms, from the Latin, it's also called interfaces et urina. Between the poo and the urine. That's natural birth channel. We know that C-section is very popular because it's less painful for the women. It's less effort, and you can even plan the party because you know it happens when you want it to happen. According to evolution, it has a huge impact because when you observe and follow the natural childbirth, the child has to go through the birth channel and it has to go through the faces at urinum. It has to go between the poo and the pee, the urine, which is very important for the further development of the child. And you know why? Because this is actually the time when the child gets all the necessary bacteria from the mother to build up a proper immune system. Planet with a natural childbirth. Very interesting. Think about this. That's evolutionary medicine. A person in evolutionary medicine would never refer a pregnant woman to a C-section. Because of this aspect. Very, very interesting. Another observation I found, it's do menstruation cycles have an impact on the health of women? Yes, they have. Also evolution. In the earlier generations, the main job of a woman was, you know, children. Bring the children to this world. And there was no anti-baby pill. So you could not artificially regulate your menstruation cycles. With the new technology we have, birth control by using chemistry, anti-baby pills, by using other technologies, what actually happens is we lower the menstruation cycles of women during their lifetime. There was a study done based on this finding, which is very interesting, because one researcher, he said, let's have a look in convents. Let's have a look at convents where the nuns live, because the nuns are not allowed to birth to get children. And believe it or not, the cancer rate in convents is about 6 to 8 times higher comparing to people living in a normal environment. It's because of the menstruation cycles. Yeah? Because they have too many cycles, and that may have an impact on the hormone system, which then relates to breast and ovarian cancers. There is a correlation to it. Very interesting. And then last but not least, all these civilization illnesses, we have to look into the environment and look into the evolution to fully understand why we build certain diseases which were not known 50, 100 now we have them, you know, exploding, not only here, wherever, it doesn't matter, it's all over the world, you know. Here in India, especially in New Delhi, you have the same problem that you have in Bangkok, or you have in New York, or you have in Los Angeles. The air pollution, the high concentration of mobile phones, that means a lot of artificial information. Well, these people suffer from a higher risk of developing all kinds of civilization illnesses than people living in the countryside. With less pollution, with a more natural environment, and so on and so on. If you are interested in evolutionary medicine, educate yourself. This is a quite good book. It's called Principles of Evolutionary Medicine, from Peter Blackman, Alan Beale, and Mark Hansen. It's in English, it's available. It's quite fascinating, you know, to get a sneak peek into this new emerging faculty. And for the lay people who are not so medically sophisticated, there is a book, it's called Why We Get Sick. This is the story about evolution on a more understandable way, new science of Darwinian medicine. It's also written by an MD and a PhD. So this was a little introduction. Gives you an idea of what's going on the whole day. So you're going to learn a lot of new stuff, a lot of new perspectives. And this was just one of more to come. But you definitely deserve a break now. And if you ever start taking things seriously, just remember that we are talking monkeys on an organic spaceship flying through the universe. That's what we actually are. We are just a tiny part of an entire, very well-designed and interdisciplinary system. And I know we always think we are the greatest, but we are not. We are just a small, tiny part of it. So you definitely deserve a break now. Thank you very much. Basic rules in energy medicine. I would like to introduce you this technology now and PEMF, pulse electromagnetic fields. But I will not introduce it to you the way that I explain in the machine, because this is done in 5 minutes. Remember what I said when I started my lecture? It is much more important to understand what happens with our organism when we lie on such a mat, because as we figured out, we don't feel anything, you know, we don't sense anything. Some people do, by the way, but most of the people don't. And therefore, it is necessary to understand the basic knowledge and the perspective of the technology which we call magnetic resonance stimulation, MRS, or with a new system, it's called IMRS, intelligent magnetic resonance stimulation, because we build in some biofeedback option so that we can even observe the reaction of the autonomic nervous system during a session on this volumet, and in case it is necessary to correct some patterns to make it even more accurate to the individual person who is using it. But basic knowledge and perspective of magnetic resonance stimulation, in order to understand energy medicine, we have to start dealing with terms, for example, frequency. Frequency is nothing else than the existence of information. So for example, if I talk to you now, my vocal cord is gaining a tone, and if I move my tongue in the right direction, every millisecond, I create a language. So I'm able to communicate with you. I'm able to create frequencies. I will send them to you over my mouth and over the microphone. And in case you are able to understand this information, you start resonating with it. Because that's what happened in the first hour. I give you a lot of information, and you were sitting there, as far as I observed it, you probably understood 99% of it, and then you start you start thinking about it. You start resonating with it. Wenn ich jetzt Deutsch spreche, wenn ich jetzt die Lecture in Deutsch mache, dann fange ich an zu reden. Ich mache genau das Gleiche. Ich sende meine Daten über meine Vocal Cords und ihr versteht nichts. What I said is, if I change the German language, I create exactly the same sound. However, the information is not pleasant to you anymore because you are not able to understand it. And therefore, you are not able to resonate with it. Does it make sense? Yes, it does. So, if we want to utilize energy medicine for our health, we have to make sure that we always apply information, that we always apply a frequency which the body is able to understand and to resonate with it. Right? This is one of the basic laws in energy medicine. And the bad part of it is we have information available which the body is resonating in a good way, so it actually triggers and turns into some good action, some positive action of the body. And on the other hand, we have frequencies and information which are which can be swallowed and which we can go in resonance with, which our body goes in the wrong direction and deals with it. So the frequency, the content of the information is crucial whether we create a positive, a negative, or no effect at all. You couldn't find it. This is a much better way to go than this. Because if your frequency is like this, you will probably attract your second half, which is also like that. So, you know, this is, I know these are very simple examples, but most of them are so simple that we don't use them anymore. But you cannot expect, when you walk through your life like this, that you always have happy people around you. If you want to be surrounded by happy people, be happy yourself. If you want to be surrounded by angry people, you have to be angry. And it will automatically happen. It's as simple as it is. So if you are exposed to a lot of angry frequencies, your body will become angry. If you're surrounded by a lot of positive frequencies, your body will resonate in a positive way. When we talk about the environmental factors and the impact on our health, we often realize that whenever we go on vacation, you know, our health, our subjective feeling for health becomes better. Why? Because we change the water of the fishbowl. We change the environment. We mostly choose an environment which is more pleasant, more quiet, less artificial. You know, we are surrounded by nice people. Everybody is not under stress. And our body immediately resonates with it, and you know, our subjective health becomes better. We feel more energized, we feel more relaxed. You know, this is energy medicine. You know, unfortunately, after two weeks coming home from vacation, it takes less than 24 hours. You know, and we are again in this vicious circle. So the idea of energy medicine is to apply as many pleasant information as possible to create a pleasant effect from the organism. That's what it is. So frequency matters. So which kind of frequencies do we know from physics? When we talk about electromagnetic fields, a lot of people who have no basic knowledge on physics, they always think we talk about electricity and magnetism, because the word describes that, right? However, the electromagnetic spectrum is far more than electricity, current, and magnetism. Everything which you see here is part of the electromagnetic spectrum. There is one mistake here. Do you know which one? Sound and light is part of the electromagnetic spectrum. Magnetic fields, electricity, infrared, microwaves, X-rays, gamma rays are all electromagnetic, but not ultrasound. Because ultrasound is a mechanical force, a mechanical wave. Therefore, a mechanical wave is not part of the electromagnetic spectrum. The interesting thing on this is that, you know, we have a lot of people from the classical medical field. You know, without energy medicine, you could not practice. You probably didn't realize this one yet. Because without the energy medicine, you would have no X-rays. You would have no infrared. You would have no MRIs. This is energy medicine. It's just utilized in a different way. And because this is all regulated, it's good. If we talk about using pulse electromagnetic fields for therapeutic purposes, which is barely not regulated at all, it can be good. However, we use exactly the same modality. We just probably use different information, frequency, because we want to reach a different effect. But talking about electromagnetic fields, this is the entire spectrum of electromagnetism. So it's by far more than just electricity and magnetic fields. The next thing about frequency, which is important, is there are frequencies that we as human beings can hear. For example, radio waves. Listen to music is also energy medicine, because what you actually do is very simple. When you look for your favorite radio station, what do you do first when you turn on your radio?
You adjust the frequencies.
You adjust the frequencies. Aha! Okay, so you're looking for 101.5 FM, whatever. Once you found your frequency, which you would like to resonate with in that moment, what do you do next? You adjust the volume. Rule number two in energy medicine, not only frequency matters, intensity also matters. And the interesting thing is, when we look for our favorite radio station, is the fact that when we found our favorite radio station, sometimes we have the tendency to listen to lower volumes, and sometimes we would like to ramp the volume up. Especially when we feel tired in the morning, and then you know, look for a radio station that, oh, this song is cool, fun. And then, you know, life goes, life works, you know? So you energize yourself by not only adjusting the right frequency, by also adjusting the right intensity. Rule number three, when you adjust the intensity, the frequency will not change. So these both properties are working independently. Very important, because I figured out that a lot of people always mix frequency and intensity. It's very important. And you know, when you change the intensity, the content of the information will not change. The song will be the same. Just the amplitude of the information will increase, the volume will increase. This is also basic knowledge we need later on to understand how pulse electromagnetic fields work. So we can hear, we can see frequencies, visible light. We are mostly realized that we are depending from light frequencies, but we don't have it anymore. You know, if you walk through your house and suddenly there is no electricity anymore, you have a problem. Because you get insecure because you cannot see where you walk anymore. So this is easy to understand that you know, light frequencies, because when they are there, we can see them. When they are gone, we miss them. So that's understandable. There are frequencies we cannot see, we cannot hear, or we can feel them. For example, infrared waves. What do infrared waves create? Heat. So infrared is also used in medicine. For example, to ingredient purposes. However, it's not good for the food. And if you put diesel in your Ferrari, your 12 cylinders will not work properly. By the way, if you have a Ferrari at home, you know, what do you do? Would you ever put diesel in your Ferrari? You know, whenever you drive your Ferrari and this red light is coming up, it says oil, what do you do? You immediately look for the source, for the best oil, and you refill the oil in your Ferrari. You know, you even on the weekends, you go in the garage, you hug it, you know, you cuddle it, you smell it, you know. Why don't we do that with our own bodies anymore? We put diesel in our organisms every day. When the red light is coming up, that the oil is not there anymore. Respectively, we have the symptoms, for example, that can trigger a heart attack or whatever. You know what people do nowadays? They got a hammer and they kill the light. That's what people do. Which finally ends in heart attack, stroke, because we always blend out these warning symptoms. We will never do that with a Ferrari. That's why the Ferrari lasts forever. Because we maintain it properly. And there is, by the way, there is a reason why we maintain our Ferrari so properly and we don't do it with our own body. Do you know the reason for it? There is a very important reason. Because the Ferrari costs 200,000 in the low frequency range. That is actually what we apply. The biggest problem we have with this kind of technology is that we cannot hear these frequencies, that we cannot see them, and we cannot even feel them. And that makes this kind of modality wacky wacky. You turn on this unit, do it right now. And then I start. Nothing happens. It doesn't become warm, it doesn't make a noise, doesn't blink. So of course we think that's, you know, it's not valuable. Because from our understanding, from our education, you know, an injection has to create pain. Ouch! There's something going on. You know? When you swallow a pill, you have to create effort. You know there's something going inside. So there must be something going on. Here, you don't feel anything. Fortunately, I have a little organ here, which we created during our evolutionary process by you know, getting this to the people. And this organ is called a little Micmac handy. And this little Micmac handy is comparable to a Geiger counter, where you can detect metal. So actually, when I turn this on,
is this okay?
So this is what happens when I turn on this device. It makes a noise. Can you hear that? Not good. create fast electromagnetic fields, of course we cannot trigger them because we don't have the organ yet. This little device can do it. So, what happens when I use this little device? I go a little bit closer to this whole body map. Electromagnetic field, which is created around this applicator. And this pulsating electromagnetic field is there. It's capable, it's measurable. Not for us, but for devices which are designed to make it possible. So actually there is something going on. So when you lie on this unit, this is actually what your body receives without you knowing it, because in sensing it, because you don't have the organ for that. By the way, there are animals, they have organs to detect electromagnetic fields. Beside the, for example, birds, they have magnetite crystals in their brain. They are able to detect the electromagnetic field of the Earth to navigate. And there is another very impressive animal. It's the shark. The shark has even an organ which is able to detect and to follow electromagnetic field. You can write this down and Google it. It's called Lorentz's ampules. Lorentz's ampules. There are only two animals known in the world as of now which have this property. It's the shark and it's the stingray. And these two animals, they use this ability to hunt. Because when fishes are moving, they create an electromagnetic potential by its movement, which can be detected by the sharks or Lorentz's ampules, so they can follow the fishes and hunt them. Cool stuff. You know, we are too dumb for that. We don't have this. We don't sense these kind of information frequencies, and therefore we think they are not there. And therefore we think they cannot do harm and they cannot do good things for us. It's the same with mobile things. Mobile phones, not so much, right? Okay, that's just go on standby. Okay, that's okay. Aha! When they are on standby, they start becoming nervous. They emitting electromagnetic fields. When you move them, they're becoming even more nervous. Do you know why? Can you hear that? When I move it a little bit, I'm really nervous. The reason is because there is a job number one of a mobile phone is to stay connected with the provider. Because otherwise no money and no phone calls. Does it make sense? Yeah. So there's an amplifier within. And whenever you change the position of the mobile phone still tries to stay connected to the provider. So when the signal of the provider becomes low, the mobile phone automatically amplifies the reception. Worst case, now reflecting on how this can have an impact on our health is, you have a mobile phone and you use it as an alarm clock on your nightstand. Unfortunately, in your bedroom, at the nightstand, there is a very bad reception. It happens in a lot of bedrooms. There is a bad reception, at least in the mobile phone. So, when this is on the nightstand and use it as an alarm clock, and you still are connected to the provider, what happens is, the mobile phone is here and your head is here. The mobile phone always amplifies the signal. So there is a huge huge electromagnetic field, artificial electromagnetic field exposed by the mobile phone, which creates interacting effects with your body. The result is you definitely sleep less better. Less good. Because it just creates an artificial environment which your body is not able to resonate in a positive way, and then it gets distracted, your brain becomes distracted because it always hears this nasty information, and you cannot get into the so important REM phase when you sleep, and this will lead to the fact that when you wake up on the next day that you feel like you work for 12 hours.
So you know what you're saying is where the signal strength is low, the EM radiation from the phone is much more.
Exactly.
That's not problem.
Exactly. Because it always tries to get the best connection to the provider.
That's why it's necessary to get the right one.
Exactly. And you know, you can also figure out that sometimes your battery becomes low very quickly.
Yes.
So that always happens when the reception is bad, because then the signal needs to be amplified, and that sucks a lot of juice out of the battery.
Like, you know, keeping the Wi-Fi connection on there, the Wi-Fi is there or not, the battery tends to go back. So
yeah.
It's trying to amplify all of that.
It's not her heartbeat. You know, it's a watch which she gets an artificial electromagnetic shock every second. She probably didn't know about that until today. And she will probably not wear this watch anymore. Can you hear that? This is electromagnetism. I stay here. Can you hear it? Now pop. Let's see what happens. Aha! You don't need a ringtone anymore. There is an immense electromagnetic field gained when a phone call is coming in. No. Is it? Can I take the call, or is it too costly?
You can.
I can. Okay, so just leave it. So now, this is actually the information which goes into your brain while using a mobile phone, while talking to somebody. He's not talking, it's not his voice. It's just the electromagnetic exposure of a mobile phone when you use it. So, some people use their phones for half an hour, 45 minutes. This is what the brain hears. This is what it is.
Huh?
Okay, thank you for that. See, your Bluetooth is much higher. The carrier frequency of a mobile phone is between 800 and 1900 megahertz. To make that more understandable, that means the mobile phone works with a basic information. So we talk about billion of cycles a second, which we are exposed to when we talk to our best friend on our day. To a dramatic increase of brain tumors. So there must be something in addition to the thermal effects to heat up the tissue, which this information in the high frequency range, which triggers some certain processes on a cellular basis to turn into a malignant situation. I can just, you know, please you use your smartphone wisely. And if you don't use it, put it on flight mode. We have people look where his smartphone is. I saw this yesterday, but I didn't want to tell you yesterday. I just wanted to give the lecture first. You know? Putting the smartphone here is really not good, because you interfere with the only organ which has its own electrical source, and that's the heart. You know? the frequency of the
megahertz is the 110 is a megahertz required for the phase shift for the heart.
Yeah.
Similarly, I read it, I found it also for the brain also.
Yeah.
This is a 90 basically.
Yeah.
And for the body, it is 70. And for 70, it's a healthy body is there. And when it comes down to 40%, starts feeling old age and it is tired. And look, what this is written in the DMI cancer, I read the article. And below 40, when it goes, it's the old age, process is there. And once it has come down to 20, it's a dangerous mark.
Mm-hmm.
Getting below the 20 further, the cell loses their 17 millivolt. It's only 50 millivolt. Then
yeah.
The survival of the fetus is dead.
Yeah.
The millivolt is,
yeah.
That's a different,
yeah.
Different number.
Yeah.
No?
Yeah, that is.
That's the current.
Yeah. So, 50, that is survival of the fetus there among the cells themselves.
Yes, yes, because you, the usual, the maintaining current of the cell itself is about minus 70 millivolts.
So that's why cancer can be in any part of the body,
yeah.
Of the body too.
Yeah.
And for the brain, what we have seen is that patient under the coma, for months together, for under the paralysis, and once it is on the machine itself, he has started walking after 6 months. Because the work has been raised to the 90.
Yeah.
And similarly in the chronic neuropathic pain, we are seeing that it works wonderful because it has come to the 90 millivolt.
We talk about this metabolic thing.
That's what we say. It's
basically
catabolic product, which is to be thrown up.
Yeah.
That is eliminated by this frequency.
Yes.
Just for a very
It
is there. We are seeing it daily also. The tumor growth is stopped.
Yeah.
Because of that.
Yeah. We use this applicator. You can hear the frequency, the intensity, right? So if I apply this on my back, okay? And if I measure on the front, it's still measurable. Because electromagnetic fields, they go through entire material. So these cameras, they don't block it, they probably interfere the frequencies with additional artificial frequencies so that the frequency cannot resonate with the provider anymore.
Can I add,
you cannot block this.
Can I answer that question?
Yeah, use the microphone because otherwise only the
antenna actually works with a stronger frequency, so it will probably increase the exposure to the PMF because Jamal has a much stronger PMF generated. So it just interferes with the signal, doesn't stop it.
Or
the phone is not able to function.
Say the with the signals coming from outside the premises.
And the jammer
is the jammer almost creating a higher to block
this. So there will be much more.
But in the rest of the premises where say in an office where there are such instruments lying, at least they won't be activated. And the immediate effect on the people, that would be neutralized.
This is the jammer.
But also the people next to the jammer will be probably even more exposed.
More exposed, yes.
Because the jammer does not block the frequencies, it just creates other frequencies
which
interfere,
yeah.
And then this creates additional frequencies. Whenever two frequencies meet, an additional frequency is gained. We have to understand that. And because we, from physics, we cannot block electromagnetic fields. You can't do that. It's not possible. They don't. Otherwise, you would have no reception in your house. But you have, because these electromagnetic fields, they go through entire material, which is then, if we use it for therapeutic applications, which is a perfect good property, because we can go through the entire organism to create an effect. A big advantage comparing to laser or infrared. Laser or infrared has a very limited penetration depth. So when we apply laser or infrared, we cannot go as deep as we want. You know, with electromagnetic fields, we can go everywhere without creating a harm. And we affect actually on sound, on light, on ultrasound, on electricity, on infrared. Most of them, of these reactions, are capable. When we talk about low pulse electromagnetic fields, let's say in the range between 0.5 and 25 hertz, which is the so-called biological window, where we create an effect, we cannot sense that.
However, they create a tremendous impact on our organism. And we will, a little bit later on, explain which kind of reactions, which kind of interactions we create between these exposing fields and the human or even the animal organism. So, the reaction is still a question mark. How do we react on these kind of pulse electromagnetic fields? By the way, there is not one magnet inside these applicators. People always think, aha, there are magnets inside. There is not one magnet inside. What we actually do is, there is no magnet inside. We feed these copper coils with electricity, which is interrupted by certain breaks, so that we are able to create a frequency, and we send this frequency into this copper coil, and this copper coil takes the current and creates a magnetic field around it. This is the technology how EMF works. We are the only manufacturer who uses solid copper coils. Most of the competitors use mesh wire, insulated mesh wire. It's because it's much cheaper to manufacture. However, the quality of the light magnetic field is much, much lower. And the interferences between the windings here with an insulated mesh wire is much higher. So in other words, the applied magnetic field is not pure. With this system, with the IRS, it's solid copper, it's very expensive, but it creates the most pure and most controllable electromagnetic field in regards to the frequencies. And the frequencies are crucial, we learned that, whether we create a positive or negative or no effect. So this is actually what's inside, there's no magnet inside. Okay. If we want to understand which kind of frequencies we as human beings resonate very well, let's take a look at nature, which kind of natural frequencies we can find there. The first natural source of frequencies is the Earth magnetic field. I explained that already. It's measured. It's scientifically proven. The Earth magnetic field has an average carrier frequency between 11.75 and 11.79 Hertz. Natural frequencies disturb and change networks in the natural frequency spectrum. That's the main negative effect. We know already what the artificial frequency do. The artificial frequencies, I would not even say that they harm us primarily, but they interfere with natural existing frequencies. So it's not the primary effect which I'm so concerned about, it's more the effect that the artificial frequencies disturb the natural frequencies. And therefore, we are actually not suffering from an overload of the artificial frequency, we are more suffering from a deficiency of the natural frequencies. That's what I'm more concerned about. You know, it takes away our essential information which we need to drive it right. And that's the problem with all these unnatural frequencies. Here we have the example with the MRI. We have an approximately factor of 100,000 times higher field, and therefore it explains a lot. So the effects of electromagnetic fields on the organisms finally depend on the strength of the field, which we know as intensity now, the information content of the field, that's the frequency, and then there is another interesting thing, how do we apply this? How do we apply the frequencies to our receiver? And physics provides us with a lot of packages, how we can do that. We call them waveforms. And in our organism. And because we talked about the basic understanding already, it's very simple now to explain this to you.
What actually happens when you apply a pulse electromagnetic field to the body? This is a single body cell. We have about 75 trillion of them. The human cell is actually the smallest building block in our organism. It's not the smallest item, but it's the smallest building block. A lot of cells together create tissue. A lot of tissue together create an organ. A lot of organs together create an organ system. So when it comes to health and disease, everything always starts in the smallest building block, which is the single cell. Does it make sense to you? Definitely. So in order to maintain a perfect healthy status within our entire organism, we have to take a look what happens in the single cell during its lifetime. The main job of a single cell is very simple. It has to create what? Do you know that? What's the job of a cell? It has to create energy. Very funny, huh? It has to create energy for what purpose? Number one purpose of a cell, why it creates energy? It needs to keep itself alive. Very simple. As long as the cell keeps itself alive, it is able to divide, it is able to replace itself. Once a single cell is dead, game over. You know? Unfortunately, whoever created us, this individual put a program inside us which allows a cell to divide only a certain amount of time. Well, we call that aging. Fortunately. So the older we become, you know, we come to a certain point where a single cell is not able to divide itself anymore, the cell dies. And the older we become, the more we have to face this kind of function. And that's why we literally deteriorate, and that's why we know what we call aging. You know? If we get wrinkles, that's nothing else than we lose more cells than we are able to reproduce. So, you know, we lose surface, and that creates wrinkles. And it comes to a certain point where the cell division comes to its last cycle, and then the cell dies. But what can we do to interfere with this process? Is very simple. We can try to prolong the cycles between the single divisions, because that will finally prolong our life. So if we maintain the cells on the highest possible level, we have a very good forecast in regards to increasing the lifetime cycles. So we literally postpone the cellular death cycle, and that gives us a longer life automatically. Because every disease starts in a cellular level. So in order to produce this energy and maintain these life cycles, we need fuel. Every power plant needs fuel to drive. So our human cell. So where is the fuel? Where do we get the fuel? Very simple. Now we get back to the Ferrari. From what we eat and what we drink. You know? So the quality of the fuel is very crucial when it comes to the lifetime cycles of a cell. The better the minerals, the nutrients, the better the quality of oxygen, the easier for the cell to metabolize this, the easier to create the energy, which is by the way called ATP, adenosine triphosphate. This is the stuff which we know as energy, which drives and drives the cell. So the better the quality of the minerals, the nutrients, the oxygen, the better it can be absorbed and utilized by the little power plants here inside, which are called mitochondria. And these mitochondria, they change the fuel into energy. And this energy, this ATP, is finally the stuff which we need to talk, to move, to think, you know, to exist. The more ATP we have, the better we can exist, the more energy we have, the more healthier we are, and so on and so on. So, fuel is crucial. So, whatever you do to maintain a healthy lifestyle, make sure that your fuel intake is the best quality that you can provide. Whatever this is. You know? It depends from some other influences which I don't want to talk today. But in general, that's the fact. The better the fuel, the better the quality of energy you create. And now, and thank you for this question, because now we come back to what he said. He was mentioning that each cell has a certain electric potential, which is also measurable. In fact, it is. It's the so-called cell membrane potential. The cell membrane potential, and now comes the energy in place, is gained by a mechanism which is mostly unknown in the classical medical field. Do you see these bubbles here? These are ions. Remember what I told you about the lithium ion battery? To charge the lithium ion battery, you need what? You need to apply a magnetic field. Ampere's law, part 2. So what happens when you apply a magnetic field? You attract the ions to move. But you only do that if this magnetic field pulsates. It has to pulse. A magnetic field will never attract the ions. With a charger it's the same. You know, you have to apply a pulsating field, 50 hertz or 60 hertz, otherwise you cannot attract the ions to move, otherwise the battery will not charge. So literally, the membrane of the cell, the entire cell structure, is similar to a battery. Similar to a battery which always needs to be recharged to maintain its own properties. In our case, if we apply a pulsating electromagnetic field, the ions start moving, they create a potential. This potential leads to the fact that the membrane, the surface of the membrane, literally becomes bigger, becomes more strong, creates a higher electric potential. The better the membrane potential of the cell, the easier to absorb the mineral nutrients and oxygen. So if you have a higher absorption rate, you have a better quality of the ATP you produce. And who works with nutritional products? Any kind of nutritional products which are on the market. Sometimes you try to support people with nutritions and you don't see an effect. I can exactly explain what happens. You can only utilize nutritions when the membrane potential of the cell is high enough to absorb that. So, in fact, a lot of people, when they take the nutrition, but they don't have a proper membrane potential, they cannot utilize the nutrition. So it's 500 rupees in, 500 rupees out. No effect. That's actually what happens. By applying a pulsed electromagnetic field within a certain intensity and frequency range, which the body is able to resonate with and to create a beneficial effect, you know what happens? You increase the membrane potential, you increase the absorption rate, you increase the amount of energy, of ATP the cell is producing. You create a healthier cell. And if you do that in 75 trillion cells, you have probably the most fundamental impact you can create nowadays on your personal health. And this is exactly what EMF technology does. This is the effect it creates. And now maybe you understand, reflecting back on what I said before, this system doesn't care what your problem is. Because it only cares about, you know, increasing membrane potential wherever necessary, and therefore shifting your body into a status where it's being able to produce more energy. And this energy, that's what we call the self-healing ability. You know, more ATP, more powerful immune system, more powerful digestion, and so on and so on. So you literally shift that situation, and that creates this fundamental effect. And this is what this technology does, not less, not more. Very simple, but very fundamental. Did you get it? Really? So I decided to speak a little bit louder. I think it was a very good lunch, a light lunch, so everybody is pumped up. We create a lot of ATP.
Well, the ATP is used for the sleep only.
Pardon?
I said the ATP is utilized for the sleep only.
Yeah. So then we get a little bit of a more proper idea how we can implement the IMRS in our medical practice, whether it's the holistic or the classical approach. It fits for both. It fits for everybody who is able to, you know, to let it into their routines. And therefore, we look a little bit more into technology in regards to applications. And we have a built-in database in the IRS. It's called the iGuide, where we have about 250 conditions preset with the application duration and the frequency pre-installed, so that you don't have to even think about what to do. This iGuide was developed and based not on scientific research. It was simply based on meta-analysis. So, you know, the more user you gain, the more feedback you receive. And then, you know, when you have enough data, you can start categorizing these different feedbacks into certain diseases. And then you look a little bit how people use it with these diseases as an accompanying modality. And then you figure out that when you look at the database, that you know, with certain conditions, there are always certain settings which apply best. And this is actually what we put in the database to make it easier for you, especially if you use it in the medical practice, to apply it to the people in regards to which kind of condition they are suffering from. However, again, you know, the IMRS is not designed for these certain conditions, but based on the experience we collected, we can support your application with kind of a guideline that makes it easier for you to apply the modality. So what we can actually set as parameters for the IMRS is, I mentioned that already, it's the duration of the application, which is, you know, mainly between 8 to 24 minutes for an application. So you see, it's not a long time to apply that. And the 8 to 24 minutes are not because within this time frame we reach the best results or whatever. We just figured out that, you know, when we reach a certain time, the cell is not receptive anymore because it got already the necessary amount. Yeah, and what it needed, and in 24 minutes, it's the crucial time. After 24 minutes, not so much happens anymore in regards to increasing the membrane potential, and therefore it would just make no sense to apply it longer. You cannot overdo it. That's the good message, because when you apply a natural pleasant information to our body, when the body gets enough, it just closes the doors. But you cannot overdo it, you don't overdose it. It just doesn't resonate with it anymore. So it's actually waste of time to use it longer than necessary. But you could even lie on this device for 24 hours, you would not create a harmful effect. But it's just waste of time. That's why, you know, these short duration of application is enough. We can adjust the intensity. And what we learned from traditional Chinese medicine, what we also try to implement in this kind of technology, is that our body works on the basis of an organ clock. So that means not all organs are active the same time of the day. So it would literally make no sense to activate certain organs when at a specific time when they don't want to get activated. For example, the liver is a night shifter. Liver detox process usually happens during the night. So imagine the liver comes from the night shift at 5 o'clock in the morning and wants to go to sleep. And then at 6 o'clock in the morning, you lie on the unit and you apply a certain frequency venom, which would activate the liver. So the liver would not be so happy about it because it just went to bed and it gets wake up again by you. And that's why we built in an organ clock. So we have four zones. We divided the day, so in 4 times 6 hours, where we use different frequency patterns in relation to the organ, to the Chinese organ clock. So that makes it more efficient. And because the system has a built-in clock, once you set the clock and you use the system, the IMRS will always relate to the time of the day you use it and adjust the organ clock automatically. And therefore controls the designated patterns which are related to this organ clock. So no matter where you use it in the morning, in the afternoon, in the evening, or the night, once the internal clock is set, the IMRS always takes the proper organ clock which is running in that system. So we figured out that creates more effectivity and also creates less unpleasant reactions. We don't create any side effects with PNF, but sometimes we create unpleasant reactions, which are also very well known as so-called Herxheimer effects or healing reactions. And I will even explain what happens when a healing reaction takes place, what actually happens in our body, and why it is so important to promote this reaction. Even if it's sometimes not pleasant for the person who get affected by it. However, a Herxheimer reaction, a healing reaction, a worsening of the symptoms is always the best sign that the body already reversed the process towards healing. And I will explain how this works. We can explain that with a modality which is very simple to understand. I call it the immune system stair. And it is related to the behavior of our immune system in regards to diseases. So what you actually see here, this is the age. I carefully went up to 120 already. A Russian scientist once calculated, very interesting, if we would always supply the best fuel, if we would always maintain the best healthy lifestyle in regards to exercise, to movement, if we would not be affected by any environmental effects, our organism would be able to live, to maintain itself for 1200 years. It's pretty cool, though. It's already. The cause of the disease is fixed so that the body gets back to 100% healing. You know, after a short delay, the immune system will also go back to 100%. It will be able to regenerate itself after a while. So that's the optimal path. That's the green path. So here, this is actually where we have to face the first disease. So now the immune system loses strength because it has to fight against it. If everything goes perfect, we catch the cause, you know, the immune system will repair that, the body will use its self-ability to heal, and the immune system over time it will regenerate and go back to 100%. After a while, we have to face the next disease. If everything will be perfect, it will always go like this. It will always go back to 100%. That's theoretical. That's hypothetical. The common path looks like the brown one here. So what actually happens nowadays, when we suffer from the first disease, usually what people do, they consult a doctor. My child is ill. What's going on? Well, it has this and this symptoms. And actually the first visit at a doctor is crucial how the further development of the disease history of this person will be determined. Why? Because if the doctor figures out the cause of the disease and not only works on the symptoms, he will do the best he can do, and he will do the right job, because then we will go the green pathway again. So the doctor helps to figure out the cause. He suggests some intervention to get the immune system, to get the person healthy again, to get the immune system back to 100%. Usually that doesn't happen anymore. What happens is, you know, it's not about the cause, it's about the symptom. So what actually happens, we treat the symptoms with certain things, which creates the effect that the immune system will never get the chance to go back to 100%. Why? Because, in other words, the more chronic the condition appears, the lower the amplitude, the volume, must be applied. But not because we create a faster effect. It's just because to prevent people from these eventual unpleasant healing reactions. That's the only reason. The more acute the condition is, the stronger the impulse can be. An acute injury is already, you are already in the healing reaction. It can never become worse. Acute is worse. So if you put somebody on the IMRS in an acute stage, you can always ramp up the intensity because you're already in an acute stage. You will not promote a healing reaction. You understand that? Yes?
Yes.
Good. That's very important for me. So it's not so much about what do you suffer from. Give me the history so that I can find a proper protocol. The main interesting question you have to ask is, how long are you? Less is more. Whenever symptoms are being suppressed and the cause is not caught, it will always go this way. Disease always goes from outside to inside, from less important to more important. These are the kind of protection barriers, walls, which our body contains of and utilizes it in case we start suffering from diseases. And the disease always takes the opposite direction, from inside to outside, and from more important to less important organs. This is actually a protocol, a so-called beginner protocol, which I figured out. We always create a reaction, and we almost never create a Herxheimer reaction. Because when we apply modality like the IRS, we want, of course, to create a reaction, a positive reaction as soon as possible. In the same time, we do not want to create a healing reaction. Probe applicator, and here again, we differentiate between chronic and acute. And additionally, we differentiate between the areas where we apply the pillow or the probe. These are the two local applicators. The probe has the most intense field intensity, about 300 microtesla,
the pillow goes up to about 150 microtesla, and the whole body mat goes up on average to 70 microtesla. So we divide the body in three areas: head, neck, thoracic, abdominal, and everything below the hip. This is how we divide it. So if somebody suffers from a chronic tinnitus, you know the hearing? A chronic tinnitus over 5 years, you just have to look, aha, it's chronic, where's the tinnitus? It's in the ear, okay, it's here. Okay, we start with 10 or 25 at 8 minutes. If somebody suffers from an acute injury caused by a car accident, because he got the wheel here on the thoracic part, that is considered acute. It's in this area here, thoracic abdominal, so we can apply with intensity 50 to 100, 16 to 24 minutes. That's how simple it is. And if somebody had a hockey game and got an injury because got a hit on the leg, it's an acute injury. If you want to treat this patient, lowering the pain, accelerate the healing process, it's acute, it's on the leg, so it's here, so we can apply 100 to 200 or even 400. The valve goes up to 1 to 1, same duration, 2 to 4 minutes. So actually, here, we keep the duration the same, and we just play with the intensities, whether we want to sedate, take energy out, or to put energy into the meridian, then we take higher intensities. Also a very good reminder, because what people always do when they use the probe, they always move it. You don't have to, because it's moving anyway. So,
put it on.
Yeah. For example, if you want to do an electroacupuncture for most of the meridians are even here inside,
yeah,
and you just want to do it as a prophylactic treatment, just hold the probe like this. And then you will see when I started, you don't have to move it because the field is moving anyway. Can you hear it? No? So you just have to hold it. All your acupuncture points get affected. No? If you have a tennis elbow, you don't have to pull it like this. Pull it like this. Because, a reminder, electromagnetic fields go through entire material. So you cover the entire area here anyway. Okay. The pillow we usually take if we have not a painful spot but more a painful area where we actually probably don't know where the cause is underlying, and then we take the pillow which has exactly the same simple structure than the probe but covers a wide area. It's not necessary. You know, the side of the probe, it is shielded with metal, so actually at the spot we have the highest intensity. So we can actually pinpoint the intensity with this spot. That's the reason why. There is a core inside, and around this core we have the copper point, the solid copper. So we could not use solid copper if we would keep it flat. Because there are a lot of windings which are crucial for gaining the magnetic field around it, and also crucial for the strength of the field. The more windings you have, the stronger the field.
For something like facial paralysis, do you both use probe or pillow?
Which we, which is our Rolls Royce. You will be equipped with the iGuide. It is the electronic database which I already mentioned. So. And I'm in the middle in the process of making probably the most groundbreaking product the holistic world has ever seen. It looks pretty simple, but it's actually pretty cool stuff. And I would like to share this with you. this product is not on the market yet. It will probably come end of the year, beginning of next year. But it might be very interesting for you to already know what we have on our plate and what we actually also bring to India, definitely. We already discussed that with Sandeep. So beside the IRS, there are exciting times ahead of us. But I need a couple minutes to get myself ready for this. And just digest a little bit.
Like your postlet list on the back and give it to the camera. The reason is we would like to send you a set of DVDs of this program that we are creating by post. And if you have not registered, kindly finish your registration also, and then you go for a tea break. So we need your postal address, then you can receive one for you. We already have your email and IDs and your phone numbers, but we need your postal address also. Thank you.
Go too deep into the details. And for me, it was really important to equip you with the basic knowledge so that you really get a fundamental understanding about the background, about the career, about where it comes from. Because based on this education you have now, when you do your ongoing research, it's going to be much easier for you, you know, to find the right answers on your questions because you have this basic background. You know, to determine, you know, now you know the basics about frequencies, now you know the basics about intensity. So when you start researching PMF and you probably come up with a lot of equipment which is available, you know, it is crucial to really look deep into the technology, what kind of frequencies are applied, how they are applied, what about the intensities, and this is something you can already determine and you are able to differentiate between the different technologies which are on the market. You know, this is, I think, more important than to go deeply into the specific things of the machine itself. Our partner here in India, Sandeep, he spent a week in Switzerland with me, and he had to listen a lot during that time because it is, you see, the educational part is the crucial part of all of this, you know? The technology itself works so simple. It takes 5 minutes to explain how the system works. And Sandeep and his team is more than happy to assist you with any specific technical questions in regards to the system. He knows everything what he has to know to answer the questions properly. So that's it. Yeah, so like I said, Sandeep will inform you about that. This is a concept which we call Intelligent Wellness Lounge. So for people who cannot afford a system or who would like to experience PMF technology, we create a concept where you can use the IMRS and open a wellness lounge or put it in an existing clinic which you already have and utilize the PMF for your patients as an additional treatment within the routine or as a standalone treatment for people who couldn't find any help as of yet. And then you can pay off your system by selling sessions to the people. So that's very successful. We have one big lounge in the UK, in Herefordshire, which is in a golf and country club. People just go there, not only people who suffer from health problems, but also athletes, you know, people who want to increase performance, people who would like to just take the power nap over the lunch break, and people who just want to experience IMRS technology, probably before they are considered to buy one, they would like to experience that. And that's how we use the Intelligent Wellness Lounge concept. And we have already several spots in India where IRS technology is available because he has already some experience with open lounges and he can tell you a little bit more about the way how it works and how to utilize this. So for the questions, I would like you to use the regular cleaning material which you use in your household. You know, except when you use it in a clinical environment, you probably have to disinfect, to use some disinfection material, which you can easily use because this surface here is certified as for medical purposes, so you can also use disinfection material on it. But if you use it in the compound, you will see that the right light doesn't do the same what the left light does. It takes a while. Can you see that? That's on purpose. You know, because we have the left side of the brain and the right side of the brain. And we don't address the same frequencies in the same time, so we actually always do it with a delay. The idea is to address the left side of the brain separately in the right side, and the idea is of the hemispherical the synchronization is over time that we get the balance between the left side of the brain and the right side of the brain. And this exactly happens with the sounds too. So there is always a different frequency experience. It's much deeper, even of the PMF application, while using the goggles and the earphones at the same time.
Thank you very much for a very illuminating day. Having been trained in the Western system, the classical medical system, I learned a lot of things which I think that other doctors should also make an effort to learn. I have a comment rather than a question, which is for the others as well. A lot of the doctors would say that these devices are not FDA approved, because that's how the pharmaceutical companies and the other device companies sell them. But in India, under the regulatory framework, CE mark is good enough.
Yeah.
So if you have CE mark for your devices, that can be the answer to the patients who come to you or clients who say that your devices are not FDA approved. So
yeah.
Just to emphasize that CE mark for Indian regulatory system is good enough.
Well, besides the side that we have, of course,
does it stand for CE?
CE mark is the European equivalent of the quality for medical devices.
CE means certified.
But
of course we have CE for the system, but in addition, the IRS is also certified as a medical device in Europe, and we are also listed and regulated with the FDA. So we are
covered.
You know, rock and roll, good to go.
Making us aware with something we both wanted here. I would like to know something because we have been dealing with the MRI systems, that what are the various precautions for the patients who are having the contact lenses or the inner ear?
Of course, from surgeries or whatever, titanium implants, no problem, no contraindication, no interference, no interaction. So these are actually the only contraindications we have to mention. Even a patient suffering from cancer, during cancer and during chemotherapy, not a problem. There is not one study
published. FDA now. FDA has approved it for the cancer.
No, FDA, no. We cannot approve a holistic device for cancer.
But
you know,
they have written it in the FDA.
We have regulated and listed it with the FDA in regards to product safety. It's not regulated to use it as a therapeutic device for cancer, but it is regulated as safe and not harm anything. So that's the most important thing, you know.
If somebody uses this system for more than the required, what side effect it may have?
Nothing. You know, really nothing. It's like, you know, if you fill up a glass, when the glass is full, because they are not educating evidence. You know, they just feel that it's a good vibration.
That we send a magnetic wave into the body and check the position of cells, etc. So he said that every cell is actually producing some electrical potential, electromagnetic field, you can say. So what the scientists now who have made this creative software, they have divided the body into 40 different zones. So you have the body, and 70 would be the physical parts, 70 points would cover the psychological part, and 6 would be the chakras. Right? So basically what they've done, backed up by the research of 10 years, 15 years, they've divided the body into 40 zones, and they say, ideally, supposedly if it's my left hand, left wrist, ideally if it needs to be healthy, it should vibrate between this frequency band to like supposedly 130 megahertz to 170 megahertz, right? This is the ideal bandwidth within it should vibrate. Supposedly, the cell starts deteriorating, the frequency will drop. So if supposedly if I take a scan of my hand and it comes out to be 110 supposedly, it's lower than the ideal frequency, then this lower frequency would be identified by the software, which the software will give you a color, for example, red. That means then the software also gives you interpretation that what does that color mean? Red is for physical malfunction.
I got a lot of good vibrations during the day. I also observed people. So that actually, thank you for that, because that kept me going.
Thank you.
So thank you so much for taking our time, and we hope we invite you every month now.
Thank you.
I'm basically from the NewAge Foundation. I'm the founder of NewAge Foundation, and we have been into water and healing, complementary therapies, and various such kind of modalities. And this is something which came to me in an accidental way, and I've been using it for almost 3 years now. After using it for 2 years, I started selling it, marketing it. There is a concept that we have started promoting for the wellness center. So there's a wellness center or wellness lounge that we help people to set up with this kind of device, where people can come and use it. So the wellness lounge can be in your neighborhood, it can be in an office, it can be part of a hospital, it can be part of a healing center. So this is basically a place where people can go and use it. So Jalakpal is a senior officer in the army, and we've been using it for almost a month now.
One of my senior officer, he is now general. He had 5-6 years back his kidney problem, and as per the doctors of military hospital, he was not to survive more than 6 months. His kidney was very badly affected. The hemoglobin level probably was not going beyond 6-7. So while I went to receive him in the station, he was carrying a bag. So I said, what is this? So after getting to the room, he explained. And he said, my hemoglobin has reached up to 13-14. His doctors say, we don't know. And it is beyond our comprehension. You do whatever you are doing, it is beyond our. And his wife also had some joint pains and all, which has she has also got improvement. So inspired with that, that time only I decided whenever I will get sufficient money to purchase this item, I will purchase. Since last around 3 weeks, I am using it. I had sciatica 5 years back, so the pain persists in the back. The pain persists in the calf, maybe because of therapy also pain is in the calf. So I am using it now. At my knees also, I was not able to climb up the stairs without holding the railings. Then back pain, then recently I had developed some shoulder also, some pain, but that I was not able to lift my hands properly. So I have applied just for last 3 weeks. And I have got tremendous improvement. All my pains and all the are vanishing.
So this is not a treatment for any specific pain. But when the body cells are healthy, there's more circulation, there's more oxygen going into each cell, then this is naturally the body heals itself. So I have Bindu also here. She has been using it for almost.
Okay, so I've been a little bit into energy medicine because I'm a crystal healer. Crystals also work through resonance and vibration. So I understood where it was coming from, and I just thought this would be a wonderful add-on tool for all the clients who come to me. My husband and my son have been using it regularly. I have used it about 7 times, because I haven't had the time. My youngest son had a blocked ear, thanks to swimming. And I think the second session, it cleared. And he hadn't even focused on it, he just kind of came out of it saying, oh wow. One of my eldest sons, as I said, I'm giving you very short term, I mean, I haven't had it that long. my ever son's friend had come over. This was about 10 at night. He came over to have dinner with us. He was tired as hell after a long day at work. And he gets up from one session of the machine and says, wow, I feel like I've slept the whole night. All the fatigue has gone. And yesterday, a friend of mine who's actually got psoriasis, so we're going to be working on that with a fine difference. And he kind of thought for a bit and he says, you know, the only way I can describe it is it's a sense of wellness. Also, I'm finding there are like a couple of my clients, I normally combine hypnotherapy with crystal healing when I do healing sessions. But after I've introduced this, they go into the sessions far easier. It's not just about being receptive, but somehow the alpha, beta, brainwaves, whatever. And they're finding a huge difference. Some of them have had about three or four sessions, and they are already starting to feel better. None of them want to have a regular healing session without the mat now.
And she's taken the patient since last 15 years, and now she said the doctors go officially and not help me. In our patient came into the treatment room with the euro, right? But back to most of the patients in the form of paralysis.
Okay, so remember in the morning when I told you that we have all these technologies around us, you know, and now we know already a little bit that they are not so good for us. However, they are there, and we will probably not get them off the market. The tablets. Because, you know, the industry figured out that people don't use their cell phone for phoning anymore. They use it for all kinds of different stuff. The younger generation, they don't call with a smartphone. They do this. Chatting, you know, they get arthritis in their thumb with 13. You know, they use it with Facebook, with WhatsApp, with all these apps that are available, you know. So they don't use it as a phone anymore, which was the primary purpose. They use it as a communication tool, as a lifestyle tool, you know, and it became lifestyle very quick, right? So without the phone, something's missing. You know, you'd rather go out of the house in the morning without your pants than without your phone. Because I need it, I need to have it. Otherwise, I don't feel confident anymore. That's where we are at the moment. It's incredible. And we cannot turn back time. So I was thinking about how can we utilize this movement, you know, by looking a closer look at these technologies and maybe find a solution to meld this technology with the visions we have, with our idea of a new healthcare area. And then I came up with an idea which is in fact pretty simple. I figured out that in the year beginning of next year, the first comprehensive health interface in the world. And it's based on a tablet with a totally different interior, because we work with battery capacities which are not known to regular tablets. The regular tablets, they work with about 4,400 milliamps per hour. Our comprehensive health interface works with 9,000 milliamps an hour, because this is necessary to feed a machine like a PMF and to create these analog signals. And of course we work with the fastest processors available for tablets. We don't call these apps, we call it webs or maps, medical applications and wellness applications. So flexible hardware options, and we will equip this tablet with a patented Latin, it means everything. It means everything, the whole, and that's our new product. It's the only one intelligent lifestyle. The second approach we have is we would like to make health hip, fun, interesting, cool, so that even the younger people start dealing with their health already. And you can only do this if you use already existing technologies, and because every young person is already very aware of tablets and smartphones. So instead of sitting in the Starbucks coffee and listen to music, why not do your 10-minute brainwave entrainment session? You know, after lunch. Or take your 10-minute power nap. You get your mask, which we're going to supply with very super nice sound and light frequencies, and you just sit there, have your coffee, and you check out for 10 minutes. This is what I see. It's going to happen. This is the patented 36-pin connector, which we call only. And then the next question was, which kind of existing operating system we use? And the market research shows a combination of hard and software add-ons to build. This is the idea. You can build your own individual healthcare system at home based on the needs you have, you know, or wherever you go. The data interface to communicate with your doctor, clinic, hospital, insurance company, employer, social health network, whatever. Facebook is good, but it would be even better to have a health-related social network. Because that would be more interesting, especially for the health-conscious people. You know, we gotta develop such a social network, and we gotta deliver it with the comprehensive health interface so that everybody is automatically a member of it. So when you suffer from cancer, the only thing you wanna do, believe me, I know it from my own experience, you wanna talk to people who survive cancer. And if you have an address where you can find 20 people, you can share your experience with them, and you can get motivation from them. And with the comprehensive health interface, we developed the first PMF system, Android-based. We call it now iOS Android, because we didn't find a better name as of yet. But what we actually do is, I already have the screen here, I can show you. The new mat we developed is a mat which uses the same solid copper coil technology which we know from the IRS, so technically there is no difference. We didn't want to go away from it because it's so good, you know, it's just unbeatable in regards to the results. But the new mat will be divided in 6 parts, so you can fold it, and it will you know, at the end it will have half the size of the existing IMRS mat. The same with a pillow. What we can't offer at this time for the IMRS Android version is the probe. The problem is the VA converter. We cannot implement it into a probe as of now. It doesn't mean that we can do it in 2 years, but as of now it's just technically not a problem, not possible. So these two systems we will come out with. And then in addition, and this is what we discussed yesterday with you, we're going to come out with a new brainwave entrainment system, a flexible system with flexible PCBs equipped with RGB LEDs, where we can apply light waves, light frequencies in all kinds of colors. We can actually display any color, so we can implement the terms of color therapy, the terms of brainwave entrainment into one system. Run by applications. And also, instead of having the headset, we have earphones directly integrated into the mask, so that it's easy to carry, easy to handle, and people can use it. So we come out with this as well. And then also OmniSense, the biofeedback sensor, we also start implementing sensoric in healthcare. So we have this system available for the IRS, it's the so-called IBOR. What it does, when you lie on the system, it will observe via a sensor your heart rate variability. Your heart rate variability reflects your reaction of your autonomic nervous system, your stress level. So what we do already with the IRS is, when you use the sensor during an application with a basic setting, and the body becomes too stressed, so that means the intensity would be too high. The system will determine it and will automatically lower the intensity. And then it will measure again, it does this every minute.
Biofeedback.
Yes. So
So this makes an application more individual to the person lying on it. That probably answers the question, right? So in general, you should use it all the time because it is more designed to the recent situation when somebody is receiving the application.
But it works only with the mat.
Yes, it only works with the whole body mat, yes. Because only the body mat creates an impact on the entire organism, and therefore on the HRV. So we are going to use that. And this is the beginning of a new era in healthcare, because with sensoric in the future, I mean, we can probably develop diagnostic tools using sensorics, you know, using algorithms and bring that together. We can probably diagnose things without even seeing or touching a patient. So that's pretty cool. You know? And the development of the sensors is in a very fast stage right now, very fast. You know? Did you know that, I mean, even in a smartphone like the iPhone or the Galaxy, there are a lot of sensors to it. You know, you have the gyro sensor, which, for example, is responsible when you change the direction of the display that the picture automatically follows. That's done by a sensor, you know? So it's a gravity sensor. We can also use gyro sensors for determining certain health issues if we use the right algorithms. Then we have a magnetic sensor built inside. There are apps which you can download and you can determine magnetic fields around you easily. These sensors are already built, and you know there are coming more and more sensoric systems. And I think because the development goes so fast, in 2-3 years, we will probably have 10-15 additional sensors which we are able to utilize for healthcare. So that's pretty interesting. Yeah, and then, you know, we have one dock where you can also plug 2-3 different modalities in the same time and synchronize them. For example, brainwave entrainment and PMF. So you can actually train your brain and get your PMF application in one time. So you don't have to lose a lot of time anymore. You can do two things in the same time. Spa for your brain and spa for your body. So this is actually how it looks like. Just a few pictures. Here, for example, you have the adjustment of the RGB LEDs, and you get automatically the color here, which will be displayed in your goggles. So you can, I mean, this is endless. We have a built-in MP3 player where you can get in the same time wellness music, all kinds of music, which is coming out of your library from the Omnium One itself, because it has an Android system. So you can utilize MP3 player, everything which is on Android. And then we're also working on coming out with a couple of additional apps or webs already. Omnilyzer BP stands for blood pressure, so you simply can, you know, with additional hardware, you can measure, monitor, and send your blood pressure protocol to the doctor, or you can maintain it yourself. The next thing is BS, blood sugar, you know, with a little additional device, you can put your stripes in, and you can measure your blood sugar level with the Omnium One. Record the results, and over time, you know, send it to the doctor who is taking care of you. We are even able to measure blood sugar with infrared already. So the problem is, it will not be regulated. Do you know why? And they do not want a regulation for infrared devices. The accuracy of the infrared device is already 95%. So it's easily doable. The only thing you have to do to measure your blood sugar is to wear a sensor around your finger. No blood anymore. You know? We have this technology. We cannot market it because it's not be able to regulate it as of yet. It will come anyway. I just know in Germany, the number from Germany, which is a small country comparing to India, You know, we have costs of about 1.3 billion euro every year only for the blood sugar testing, which the healthcare system has to pay. You can eliminate this overnight by using a new technology with new sensoric. So there's a lot going on, really.
For personal use, you would have both.
For everybody without violating the law. You don't want to violate the law. Yeah. You came up with your idea, so we're going to implement this. Very interesting development from one of the doctors sitting here, dealing with, say it in one word, with how can we get better sleep? How can we get a more health-related sleep, which helps us a little bit more to gain back our health during sleep? There are very interesting research. There's very interesting research available, which you did already and which you figured out we could easily implement such a technology. And I already committed that we're going to do that. So we probably come out soon with a cooperative development, muscle measuring, no problem anymore. And even, believe it or not, you know, I saw the first prototype of an existing ultrasound head, which you can attach to the tablet, and you can do ultrasound for diagnostic. You know, the head is, the price of the head in serial production is about $5,000. It's nothing. You know, comparing to diagnostic solutions, remote data exchange, and global social health, there's no limit. There's just no more limit. You know, and we get it in the good thing is we get it in the hands of the people. And I think that's the most important thing, because that will change the perception about health. If people have, we have a built-in 8 megapixel camera. It's the first tablet with a high resolution 8 megapixel camera, because we also think, for example, when you are on emergency, you know, you have to share this with your community. So the price, this is a regular, the price will be the same than the existing IMRS, probably a little bit lower for the basic set. So there is a quite interesting price range. And don't forget, you get a tablet for free, which you can use. You know, like I said, here in this system, you have. I couldn't finish the software. So this is going to be one of the first analyzers where we can analyze health status of a person by using a sensor which records the emitted very low electromagnetic fields out of the palm of the hand, and then creates a comprehensive report about the health status. As soon as I finish the software, I will send you a sample, Sandeep. And I will train you, and then you can share it with the people. This is a device which works with your existing computer, and which comes with the software and the hardware and the sensor, and it will actually give you a very comprehensive report, including vitamin status or whatever, out of the palm of your hand with a measuring which takes 60 seconds.
54. I have that product.
Yeah.
The market is flooded for that.
Yeah, but not with the one we come out. Because the one you have, which is basically good, but it's very cheaply done, the translation is horrible. You know. So once the system is ready to launch the market, we will inform you, Sandeep, and then you can use your communication pathways to get it out to people.